Is this the real life? Packing. 9 beers, 2 prepared black mushrooms, millies, and a veggie roast for the fire. Snacks and a bottle of red wine, mostly in the top box to ensure that the equal weight distribution as we ride our bikes to Pumula. Look up to the skies and see. So I pulled over on the side of the N2 so we could sort out the camera work. Pulling off into the traffic isn't always the easiest thing to do. Don't rush it when you pull into the traffic. I find a lot of people will try and accelerate, pull into the traffic and rush across all the lanes to get into the fast lane. Don't do that. Pull into the slow lane, relax, settle, make sure your pillion passenger is happy. And then once you're ready, accelerate, check your rearview mirror, check the blind spot before crossing, and then cross across into the fast lane. Always good to tuck in behind a car, but also really, really, really important, watch your rearview mirror. Once you're in the fast lane, there will be someone that will come right up your ass, and you can see them coming a mile away. Don't try and accelerate away. Slow down, pull over, let them go past you, and rather watch the accident happen than be part of it. I've connected the BMW Connect app readout in the top right-hand corner of the screen. This gives you an indication of the speeds we're doing, the accelerations, and the lean angle info on the screen up in the top right. Right, so coming up on our right-hand side again as we pass this truck to the left, this is the Westwood Shopping Center. Typical example of these behemoths, so common in South Africa today. That was the E.B. Clutty Junction, just after the 1970s. It was built joining the N2 to the N3, Johannesburg. Right, looking across to our left, coming up in view now as we slow the video down, it's a typical example of the shanty towns that have sprung up in and around Durban illegally. There's no water, no sanitation, no services. They're made out of corrugated iron. It's a breeding ground for crime and disease, and it's pretty much left to rot by our government and municipalities.
Thunderbolts and lightning, very, very frightening me.
Galileo, Galileo,
Galileo Figaro.
He's just a poor boy from a poor family, sparing his life from this monstrosity.
Easy come, easy go, will you let me go?
Bismillah, no, we will not let you go.
Let him go!
Bismillah, we will not let you go.
Let him go!
Bismillah, we will not let you go.
Let me go!
We'll not let you go.
Let me go!
We'll not let you go.
Coming up on the right-hand side, as we leave Durban, is the old Natal Portland cement factory that used to be stationed close to where they had lime dug out of the ground, but has since become defunct and no longer is in operation. More on that later. A tip regarding your speed and the traffic. Best tip I got was, it's the traffic that is going to hurt you. It is the short, sharp stop at the end of your slide on the concrete that is going to hurt you. So stay away from traffic. Even if that means you need to accelerate, it is the other drivers, it is the other cars on the road that are going to cause you the most harm. So stay away from them. South Coast, here we come. To our left, coming up, you'll just start to see the oil refineries and the bluff starting to poke out their chimneys, and also you can see there's a water tower on the left-hand side and a massive shed, which is the old Durban International Airport. Now, this clip is to show you what you do when you need to fiddle around on your motorbike, adjust the music controls, and stand up, possibly take a bit of a break and let your blood circulation back into your legs. Tuck in behind a slow-moving truck, slow your speed down, and when you're ready, go past the truck and get back into the traffic. Toll roads in the South Africa area were first introduced in 1983 in Tsitsikamma, and they're integral on all national roads today. And as we turn off here at Hibbardine, we turn onto the R102, which is not tolled, and it is the old road which travels all along the Natal North and South Coast. It's a quaint dual carriageway that runs along the coast through small, pretty beach towns. The section was pretty much in very good condition. The sea is close by to the left, as well as the main railway line that runs all the way along this coastline. Between the sea and this road and most of the prime properties, a stupid planning mistake in the 1917 of putting the railway line there, that's led to the South Coast being a much cheaper area due to being unable to build directly on the seaside. And that railway line is now only used 3 times a week for transporting limestone. So as we cross the Nchambili River mouth, you can see the railway line paralleling the road to the left and Pumula in the far distance coming up to the right on that promontory. Pumula is a small seaside village about 20 kilometers north of Port Shepstone and just outside of Hibbardine. Pumula, a beautiful, leafy, established village with large, spacious holiday homes and lots of retired folk. Quite a bit of money, I would say. A lot of them are homes that are used maybe 3 or 4 times a year for family gatherings, for Christmases. And most houses boast large, estate-like yards and beautiful sea views down here in Pumula. Beautiful roads throughout the Pumula Estates areas, but unfortunately right at the end of our journey, a little bit of a rough section of road going up a very steep driveway to the most incredible view and the most amazing campsite for the evening. It's always nice to arrive at a house full of friends and a welcome arrival. That evening, we had a great time. And a stunning, beautiful camping area just in front of the motorbike, overlooking the ocean. Thank you. Up early on day two, camp packed, the beach was walked, farewells said, we headed out to Oribi Gorge. Oribi Gorge is a canyon cut by the Mzimkulwana River to the east and the Mzimkulu River to the west. It is about 120 kilometers south of Durban proper. It's nearly 30 kilometers long and it boasts a subtropical flora and spectacular kloofs and crags. The base rock of these cliffs is said to be over 100,000 million years old and forms part of the Namaqua-Natal metamorphic province. Now one does kind of wonder why they don't say a trillion years, but probably because it sounds way too much. What you do see here is a beautiful, stunning ride. Nice and slow because you don't know what's coming up around the corners. But on the right-hand side, as we make our way down into the gorge, vertical cliffs. On the left-hand side, a vertical drop, unprotected for the motorbike, for cars. So it's good to keep your speeds down. It's good to be able to look around and enjoy the ride. This road that you see in the picture was originally built by Italian prisoners of war in the 1940s, and it gets its name, the Oribi Gorge gets its name from the Oribi antelope that is only endemic to the gorge. Couple of riding tips while we're watching the video of climbing back out of the gorge up to the flats at the top of Oribi. Be aware that at any stage the road can deteriorate and that you must be prepared to deal with loose gravel, loose rock, rock slides, especially on roads like this that are subject to municipal control. And obviously you see the vehicle in front of us now as we're climbing up. Make sure they see you. In every instance, these vehicles with the beautiful view can stop at any moment, and it can cause you to ride straight into them, which isn't such a problem if you just have a bit of a bumper bashing, but can be disastrous if you're way too close to the edge and you drop your bike down that embankment. So here as we climb up out of the gorge onto the flats between the rivers, you'll see on the right hand side we come past a Christian camp that is well known in the area and has been going for well over 30 years. And it is mainly a sugarcane farming area, and it is a thriving Christian community with that well-known camp to the right, as I mentioned. And if you notice at the end of this road, there is a signboard with so much happening out in that area that it is well worth a visit to the Oribi Gorge area and up onto the Oribi Gorge flats. There is a very good nature reserve off to the left-hand side from the T-junction, about 10-15 kilometers from here, and there is a very good cafe that, as I said, has been going for many years now. And this cafe indeed is our destination for the day's lunch, Leopard's Rock Cafe. Piece of advice when parking a 300 kg motorbike: be careful that you understand you need to reverse it by hand and you have an easy access to get it out. The Leopard's Rock Cafe is just fantastic, perched right on the edge of the cliffs and looking out over the gorge with hornbills in the trees on the most beautiful decor inside and outside. The food's very good as well. Famous Leopard Rock, where the cafe gets its name from. We met some other bikers at the end of that journey who are from Shelly Beach with their beautiful new BMW, and after swapping stories, we headed back to Durban. Long ride heading back, 160 kilometers, almost 2 hours worth of riding in traffic, but what a pleasure on this beautiful big 1250 BMW that we ride. Heading back, we rode the main road out of the gorge, and this is a potholed road, more in common to the rest of South Africa's regional roads, and in fact, even the national roads are becoming more and more potholed. And we pass on this road that white area in front, a mountainside that's been stripped for its lime and is now feeding the new Natal Portland cement factory, which we come up to shortly. Here's the new factory, double the size of the old one, close to its limestone food source. We got back onto the R102 in Port Shepstone and headed back from another magic ride on our steel horse.